coming right out of the section where we defined and discussed the fundamental theorem of calculus, which we have here on the screen, the two parts, we have already established the connections between antiderivatives and the definite integral. And so what we're going to do in this section is define what is called the indefinite integral, which gives us some convenient notation for finding antiderivatives. So the indefinite integral, let's get it here in the center of the screen, the indefinite integral is defined by saying that if f, capital F of x, is any antiderivative of little f of x, which again means that capital F prime of x equals little f of x, then the indefinite integral, the integral of little f of x dx, is equal to its antiderivative, f of x. And that just gives us some nice convenient notation that doesn't really add anything new to what we've been doing, because we've been finding antiderivatives for several sections, and now we've seen the connection between the definite integral, when we have bounds on our integral, to the antiderivatives from the fundamental theorem. But now what we're doing is we're giving ourselves some new notation. So this is the notation that we're going to use when we're finding general antiderivatives. So I want to be really clear here, and let's just come off to the side. The difference, we'll do this example here in just a second, but when we find a definite integral, from a to b of f of x dx, this gives us back a number, a numeric value, and that numeric value represents the area, the net area between the function and the x-axis. That gives us back a very definitive, specific quantity, a number. This gives us the net, actually I want to write number, a number that represents the net area between y equals, the curve y equals f of x, and the x-axis. Okay, so that's what we've already defined. We've already defined the definite integral, and the fundamental theorem of calculus gave us a way to evaluate it using antiderivatives. This is actually exactly equal to the antiderivative evaluated from a to b, which is f of b minus f of a. So we get back a number when we find the definite integral. The indefinite integral on the other hand, no bounds, just the integral of f of x dx, will give me back the general antiderivative. This is going to give me back a function. When we take the indefinite integral, we get back a function. And the function we get back is the function that is the antiderivative, so f prime of x equals f of x. Okay. Or we could even think of it as a family, because we're going to have some plus c's on these. So we could even think of it as a family of functions. So to be really clear, a definite integral gives us back a number that has a physical representation of a net area. An indefinite integral gives us back a family of functions whose derivative would be our little f of x. Okay. So being really clear here, now that we have this new concept, this concept of integration. We sometimes use this concept of integration to come up with an actual area, net area between curves. Sometimes we're looking at this integration process as just generating this set of families whose derivatives are equal to the function little f of x. Okay, now let's go ahead and get back to just computation and practice with these integrals. We're going to practice in this section with both indefinite integrals and also definite integrals, really tying it all together and just practicing this process of integration. Okay, so here's our first example. If we want to take the integral of this function, now, first thing we notice is that it is an indefinite integral, okay? No bounds. So that means it's an indefinite integral. Kind of a tongue twister, indefinite integral. So this is definitely an indefinite integral, and we are looking to find the antiderivative of this function. So we had a whole table of antiderivatives where we were looking at functions whose derivative would generate these functions. We also had some rules when we were finding antiderivatives that said that you can look at them term by term. I notice as I go along, this first one is definitely going to be a trig function. I'm thinking, you know, of my trig functions and which trig function, or is there a trig function who has a derivative exactly equal to secant x tangent x. Now that constant can carry throughout, will be with the antiderivative, but looking at that secant tangent, and I immediately think, ah, that is the derivative of the secant. Okay, so I think that. Then I look further and I notice this 3x to the fourth and the 5 over x cubed and the fifth root of x here, and I'm thinking, you know what, those are candidates for the power rule. But before I can apply the power rule, I'm going to want to do a little rewrite. So kind of that's the thought process as I go along, thinking first that it's indefinite integral, so I'm just looking for a general antiderivative, then looking at the terms and thinking about, do any of them fit our general antiderivatives? And they definitely do, but a little rework here. So let's do a little rewrite on the powers. So doing that, I would get the integral of 4 secant x tangent x minus, I don't have to rewrite the first term because it's just minus 3x to the fourth, but that's actually the third term here, 5x, it's got an x to the third in the denominator, so I'm going to write that as x to the negative third using my rules of exponents, and then I've got 8 minus 8x to the, again, rules of exponents, x 8 times x to the 1/5 dx. Now that's also telling me, that differential right there is telling me what I'm integrating with respect to, and I am integrating with respect to, I'm finding the antiderivative of this function with respect to x, okay, which is actually what the function is in terms of, so I'm going to apply all my antiderivative rules here. And then I just find the antiderivative. So now go ahead and find the antiderivative. We already mentioned, obviously, the derivative. Hopefully these are familiar. The derivative of the secant of x is secant tangent. So this becomes 4 secant of x minus 3x to the fifth over 5, applying my power rule, plus 5x to the negative second over negative 2 minus 8 x2, we're adding 1 to each of the powers as we apply the power rule, so this is going to become x to the 6/5. And when I do that, I'm actually going to leave a little space here, x to the 6/5. When I do that, I'm also going to divide by 6/5, but dividing by 6/5 is the same as multiplying by 5/6. So I'm going to multiply by 5/6. Now, as I take an antiderivative, I have to remember this is a general, we're finding just the general antiderivative here. When we integrate, we're going to end up having what is called an integration constant because there's a plus c here. So this is what we call, now that we've defined the indefinite integral, we can call this the integration constant. Because we don't have a definite integral here, so we have to remember we've got a family of curves here that can vary by a constant. Any function of this form with any constant here will have a derivative that is equal to 4 secant x tangent x minus 3x to the 4th plus 5x to the negative 3rd minus 8x to the 1/5. Okay. All right, and not a whole lot to simplify here, but let's just clean it up maybe just a little bit. 3/5 x to the 5th minus 5 over 2x squared, drop that negative exponent, and minus, 2 is going to go into each of those, so minus 20 thirds x to the 6/5 plus c. And that is the integral of the function that I started with. And you can always check, let's see if I can get this all on the screen. You can always check by taking a derivative. So we could always check this by taking the derivative to see if we do in fact get back the original function. And we would. We would get back the original function here. Okay, before continuing on, I just wanted to remind us that we have an entire table of antiderivatives, and I've just reworked that table and made it a table of indefinite integrals. So it is the same table. Let's see if I can get it all on the screen here. We have quite a few of them at this point. It's kind of kind of hard to get that whole thing on the screen here. But I did post this table for you, this reference page in Canvas. So you can reference this page as we go along. But the more you integrate and the more that you work with integrals, indefinite or definite integrals, hopefully the better your comfort level is going to be going back and forth between derivatives and antiderivatives and recognizing, right? Recognizing functions and being able to connect them to their antiderivative. So for instance, here, I'm just going to grab one that we just looked at. Let's look at this one. So we looked at this guy. And so if we come across in an integral, this function, secant x tangent x, you know, connecting that back to the fact that the integral or the antiderivative of the secant x tangent x is in fact the secant x. And then of course you notice these all have that plus c because we are making that, you know, that connection when we're looking at indefinite integrals, we're making that connection that we're actually talking about an entire family of curves, meaning they all have that secant shape, but they could be shifted vertically up or down by a constant plus c. Okay, so kind of taking a look at that. And then, of course, the other one that we looked at on that particular example was we applied this power rule multiple times, actually. And so there's your power rule. When you come across x to the n, the integral of x to the n, of course, is x to the n plus 1 over n plus 1. And then we do have our plus c. Okay, so we have this entire, you know, this is really just working with all of the functions whose derivative formulas we have. We can now work our way backwards. One thing to mention, and it's come up in a couple of our sections, and that is this integral of f of kx dx, when we are finding the antiderivative of f of a constant times x. And the way we adjust for that is with this 1 over k times the antiderivative capital F of kx. And so remembering that we have that little, it's really just a very simplified backwards chain rule is the way to think of that, right? When we take a derivative, if we have k times x, embedded, composed into the function, then we have to also take the derivative of k times x, which would be a multiplication by k. So finding an antiderivative, we have to divide by k or multiply by 1 over k. Okay, that is one piece that I like to put in here because that makes finding integrals of just slight variations of all of our standard formulas. It makes it just, it expands the number of functions that we can integrate pretty quickly, pretty simply. Okay, so let's get back to a couple more examples. So we had this example. Let's take a look at this guy. So if we come across this, first thing we notice, of course, is that it is an indefinite integral. So we've got an indefinite integral here. So we're just finding the general integral here, right? The general antiderivative. So when I come across this, I notice, first of all, 7 over x, right? So I kind of glance quickly at each of these terms in this function. And I see the 7 over x is actually not able to apply the power rule, right? So here's kind of my thought bubble. Can't apply the power rule here because 7 over x is equal to 7 times x to the negative 1. Applying the power rule, that's the one case that we cannot apply the power rule to, because if we were to apply the power rule, we'd add 1 and divide by that resulting exponent, which is 0. And division by 0 is not okay. So that's the first thing I notice. And this, by the way, is going to result in a natural log. So I think natural log. So this is going to be natural log of the absolute value of x. So that's my first thought. The second thought that's coming into my mind as I'm looking at this is I notice that 2x and I notice the minus 5x. This is, so and the other thing I'm thinking about as I'm doing this, this is an integral of f times kx dx. And so what I'm going to think about when I do that, this is the one we just mentioned when we were looking at the table of integrals, this is going to be 1 over k times the antiderivative f of kx plus c. Okay? So all of that is going through my mind in a thought bubble as I glance at each of these terms. Okay? Now, thought bubble disappeared. Now let's go ahead and get right to it. So when I'm integrating this, this is going to become 7 times the natural log of the absolute value of x. We do have that absolute value of x minus, now that 2x, remember, is going to give me a 1/2. And the integral of the sine of x is actually a negative cosine of 2x. Okay. Minus, now we've got e to the minus 5x. So my k here is a minus 5. So this is going to be a minus 1/5 e to the negative 5x. Remember that the integral or the antiderivative of e to the x is e to the x. So we just get back itself. Plus, of course, a constant, and then just a minor simplification to adjust for the signs. I wanted to show all of the signs rather than simplifying as we went. So we've got plus 1/2 cosine of 2x plus 1/5 e to the minus 5x plus c. And there is my result. My integral, my indefinite integral. Okay, let's just do one more before we go. This one contains two terms, and again with the thought bubble, right? And then we'll disappear the thought bubble. But this is what I would think about when I see this. We've got to recognize that the integral of 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared dx results from an inverse sign of x. Okay? And the integral of 1 over 1 plus x squared dx results from an inverse tangent. That is the derivative of the inverse tangent. So again, the comfort level that we have with derivatives is going to help us here recognize our antiderivatives, be able to do this process of integration, right? Because whether we're working with an indefinite integral or a definite integral, we have to be able to find antiderivatives. And then if we're working with a definite integral, we'll evaluate those antiderivatives. And if we're working with an indefinite integral, we'll just make sure we have the plus c to represent the family of functions. So right away, I notice those two, and those just in my mind say, oh, they're screaming to me, oh, those are inverse trig functions, because I can recognize those. Okay, so we're going to disappear the thought bubble. So here we go. The integral is, and these are direct. There's not even any constants on them or anything. So we're just going to say, well, this is just clearly an inverse sine of x plus an inverse tangent of x plus c, because we do have our integration constant. Remember, an indefinite integral represents a family of functions that can vary by a constant. And so there's our result. So let's just end the video with one more time where we started, which was just a quick review of what the definite integral was. The definite integral represents a number, and we'll generate a number because we're going to find an antiderivative and evaluate that. And that number that is given when we calculate a definite integral represents the net area between f of x and the x-axis. Now, an indefinite integral, what we've been focused on in this video, in this section, an indefinite integral gives us back the general antiderivative. And that general antiderivative is an actual function. So when we find an indefinite integral, we're looking for a function whose derivative is little f of x.